I'm the CTO of F83. We are a company with three axes: communication, user experience, and engineering. I'm in the engineering part, obviously. We work on web application on the large sense, from front-end and JavaScript, HTML, to API, REST API, Hypermedia, and Evented, as we will talk here. It's my day occupation, and by night I'm a proponent of open source activities. I'm the lead developer of linuxfr.org, which is the main French-speaking website about Linux and free software. I'm also a translator of the RubyLang website, and I've organized the first ParisJS meetup and some other activities. I'm Bear Michel on Twitter if you want to tweet. So, the Evented Web. On the API days website, there was three edges, and I've taken them but transformed a bit. First was the web was readable. I think it's the static age from the last century, so the history of internet. We were having mostly static web pages. It's like a library. You can take some content and read it and reboot on the shelf. But you have nearly zero interaction. It's static content. Then there was some dynamic stuff happened. For example, you have the LAMP stack, Linux, Apache, MySQL, PHP. We have the MVC framework like Rails and Django, and we move from something that was very static to something very dynamic, where people interact on the same website. So we have interaction between humans and one website, but it's there is strong walls around the website, and you have nearly no communication between the website. When I'm logging on one website, I'm not logging on the other website. The same is whereas the content which is on one website doesn't move to other website. And the third age is the evented web. It's more like the brain. We have a lot of neurons, and we have some impulse, and the contents move from one area, one website to another. When you say same thing on one website, it's taken on Twitter, and it's retweeted and move. And when you push on GitHub, you have some interaction, so you can build your stuff and things like that. So, how does it translate to in technical terms? First thing is your REST API. It's one of the main bricks to build the Evented Web. But when we think about the REST API, often the first thing which comes is some clients and server which ask the server describe what is these resources, and he says you can ask me some question about that, and the client will come ask a question and the server responds. It's not very it's not an holy grail. You have to think about other solutions. For example, all these six startups, not startups exactly for the last one, have a REST API, but they have also to deal with events. For example, on MailChimp, you can subscribe or people to list, to send them mailing list, but people can unsubscribe themselves. And you, as a provider, as a website, you want to know about this event, to maybe send something to people. You have to know that there was an event. On Stripe, when a client is charged, obviously you want to know that. And you want to know that immediately. You don't want to have an email 24 hours later. On GitHub, when there is a commit, you have some interactions. We'll come back on that later. Same thing for Shopify. When a client buys something, you want to know that. On Twitter, obviously, you can watch the tweet and have some filters and something like that, the firewalls. And the next example is France Television. We have news in real time, and when you build a mobile API, a mobile application, you want to fetch this event as soon as possible to be really in real time. So one example is GitHub. When you push something on GitHub, you probably want to do something with this code. Maybe run it on an integration, continuous integration, like Travis. And when the build is OK or is red, you want to announce the results. So maybe you will publish that on Campfire. So to do that, you have the need to push the information, and not having just to one client which. Some from time to time will ask for questions. So you can do that on GitHub. If you go on your repository and in the admin part, you can have something like that, and you have what is called service hooks. So you can declare that when you push a commit. It can announce itself to other services, like Travis, and there is 100 other apps. You can do that. How it works? It's simply, it's one word, it's called webhooks. The idea is to you make an HTTP request, but it's not the guy who it's not the server which receives the information which describes the contract, how you send the request, but it's the client. In our case, it's a GitHub which say, when there is a commit, I will send you to a configured URL the information about the commit, and it with this part, this data. And the client, the server, which will receive this request, have to confirm to this contract. Sometimes it's called, don't call me, I will call you. In the Stripe documentation, I won't read it all, but it says, when a client is charged, we will call an URL that we can configure in your system to be notified. It's cool, but when you have when the contract is described by the client, and when you have other APIs where the contract is described by the server, you see that the two contracts can't be incompatible. So the solution is to put something in the middle. WebScript is one of the solutions. It will resolve the payload from GitHub. It will transform it, and we will resend it to another part. To debug it, you have something called request bin. It's a web services where you can receive a webhook and log all the HTTP headers and the payload. Okay. And a last thing about webhooks, it's pretty cool to have a REST API to manage the webhook point. For example, on Mailchimp, you have some methods to declare, I want to add a new webhook and to delete them or to list them. It's a cool thing. So webhooks it's pretty cool when you have events that are not very often and you want to push them. But when you have the firewalls of Twitter, It's probably not a good idea. It will cost too much to make all those connections. So you have to find other way. I built the API for France Television about live events. So I will take this example. When reporters write some news about anything in France, they will publish it on their back office, and then it's broadcasted to a large people on mobile, on the web, on the website, on connected devices, and things like that. So you have to broadcast it to a large set of events. There are solutions. When you are front-end guys, you probably know them. It's something you use on website to make a real cool animation, something like that. The first two one are polling and non-polling. Polling is stupid. You just ask the same question every 5 seconds, every 10 seconds. Is there anything new? No. Is there anything new? No. It's stupid, but it works. The client asks every 5 seconds if there is anything new on the server, and the server most of the time responds no. But when there is something, it can respond yes and send the information. Maybe it will send you a batch of data if there is several events were published during these 5 seconds. You can improve it a bit by using long polling. Long polling is the same thing, but instead of having the server which responds immediately, if he has no event, he waits to have an event to send. So when the client asks, is there something new? If the server doesn't have an answer immediately, he waits until he has an event, or he just time out, maybe 30 seconds later, he say no, but you don't have to. You can be more reactive because you during this this time the connection is already open and you can respond faster. It's not very efficient from bandwidth wise, but it works and it's pretty solid. It's known, so maybe it's a good solution. Depends on what you do. On the other end, you have some more complicated solution, like the firewalls of Twitter, which is HTTP streaming. You open the connections, and then you send some data on it by streaming it on by chunk. It works well when you have when you don't have to work with browsers. In browsers, it's pretty complicated to make it to use it. So maybe it's not Google solution if you want to use it on browser. You have WebSockets. WebSocket is a two-side socket to the server, between the client and the server. It's mainly used for games at the moment. It can be used for streaming events. I think it's really complicated and it's not easy to deploy to a lot of HTTP proxies and web servers are not compatible with WebSockets, so you should avoid that if you don't need it. And the last one, event source. Event source or server sent event is a specification by the W3C. I think it's really the most it's a clear winner. You combine the idea is the clients connect to the server, and then you stream data with some event. You say event and the name of content of your event, and you associate ID to the event. So if you are disconnected, you can reconnect and resend the last ID of the event you received, and you can restart the streaming from that. It's something implemented in modern browsers. So in modern browsers, it's very easy to use them. You have events, JavaScript events. So you can easily use it. If you have some old browsers, you can degrade it by using a polyfile. It's a bit of JavaScript which emulates a connection. In practice, what it will do is connect to the server, and when it receives a response, it will close the connection and will reconnect with the ID of the last response. So it works like long polling, but on modern browsers, it's more efficient. It's easy to debug, it's easy to implement. It's well supported on nearly every server. So yeah, I think you should go in these directions. The only trap is course, donc cross-origin request resource sharing is not well implemented in browsers for the moment, but it will improve soon. So I think you should do that. In conclusion, the web is now evented. It's more and more something where events are impulsed at one place and will transfer from website to website. And you should use webhooks and event source to build this future.